Thank you very much.
Yeah!
I'll tell you what, I'll make you a deal. If you each give me $500, I won't quit in May. Look, if it worked for Oral Roberts, it might work for me. Have you followed the latest story of Oral Roberts? He's at it again. Remember a few years ago, he had to raise $9 million or God was going to call him home? This week, Oral got a little trouble. He's asking his followers to send him $500 each to save his ministry. And in a similar move, Jimmy Swaggart is asking every vice operator who busted him to send him $500. So, now look, Oral says if he doesn't get the money, he wants a million people to send him $500. That is 500 million bucks, right? Now, I'm not going to keep it because I know you want to get home, get your checkbook. Oral says if he doesn't get the money, he may have to close the college.
Aww.
But you know what they say, an Oral diploma is not worth the paper it's printed on. I'm just reporting the news. Oral says he needs the money to fight a satanic conspiracy. That's right, a satanic conspiracy. He also thinks the truth about Adam and Eve was hushed up by a second apple theory. The cost of salvation is going up, isn't it? How come God's work always costs so much and the devil does it for free? Probably non-union. Or possibly with GE. Who knows? Hey. Once in a while, we slip one in. Anyway, thank you for coming. This is The Tonight Show, and occasionally we'd like to give the people who come here a little message. So tonight's message is, he who lives by the sword gets less flooding than he who lives by the river. I know. You think about that on the way home. And you'll say, what? Okay, let's try this. This is something that's been on my mind. A lot of things have been on my mind today. Sometimes my mind just gets clouded with things. You've all heard of the singer Billy Ocean, right? All right. Do you know comedian Ronnie Shell? Quite popular. Do you think if you held Ronnie Shell to your ear, you could hear Billy Ocean? Okay. Kind of sneaky inside, aren't they? All right. Here's an item actually happened here in Los Angeles yesterday. 500 cases of wine. They had a big semi-truck, apparently a jackknife on the Ventura Freeway, spilled 500 cases of wine on the freeway. Ed rushed over immediately with a drinking buddy of his and offered to suck up the diamond lane. What happened to Doc tonight? I didn't know until just a moment ago. Somebody says, Doc is not here.
No, he's not.
Well, I know. That, in essence, is my question, Joe. What happened to him? Do you know, Tom? By the way, it's Mr. Tommy Newsom who stands in front of the orchestra when Mr. Severinsen is not here. Was it an emergency, or is he conducting an orchestra somewhere?
It beats the hell out of me.
And obviously, you don't really give a damn either, do you? Yeah. Anyway, I think he's got a little touch of the flu, somebody said.
It
a lot of flu
that.
Going around, you know that? Have you ever gotten a flu shot, Tom?
I had one, and I've got the flu right now.
Yeah, I went to Arizona for my arthritis. Got it the first month. Okay, no. Anyway, we are now in sweeps month in television. You know what that means? They take the ratings. Watch some of the shows. They do anything. They have a lot of TV movies made for especially for television, usually putting women in jeopardy this month. That's true. Well, there's another issue-oriented movie coming out starring Valerie Bertinelli this month. It's Sweep Weeks. In this one, she plays a young woman with an eating disorder. It's called A Barf Bag for Barbara. Something I think that Rod Serling would have liked. if Rod was still with us. But Rod, of course, is not with us. Well, Mario Cuomo finally made a big decision today. After years of soul searching, he decided to make the switch from beta to VHS. Apparently, Mario Cuomo was in New York City yesterday, and a mugger came up to him and said, "Your money or your life?" And Mario said, "Why do I have to make up my mind right now?" Am I getting close to anything at all? Let me know when I get there. I understand a guy in the Valley was very excited today when he looked at the headline in the morning newspaper and said, "George Bush said there is no recession." Then he pulled the paper back over himself and went back to sleep on the park bench. Close. But the recession is affecting everybody, even comedians. You get less laughs when there's a recession. I saw a Beverly Hills woman today standing on Rodeo Drive with a sign that said, "I'll send my maid over to your house to work for food." But it is true. Look, I'm sailing along pretty good shape here. Some of the very high-priced restaurants in Southern California are closing because they cannot make it. One maitre d', from a very snooty restaurant here, got a new job. He was at, I think, the Bistro up here, and it closed. He's the official greeter at Forest Lawn. That's sad. I mean, you know, how many in your tomb? I mean, touch of the... I'm catching the flu. It may strike me before I finish here. Did you know that the, and let's all hope you do, that the Fox Television Network is now running ads for condoms? Yeah. Yes. True. I saw a commercial last night on for Titan condoms on Fox, and they come with an expiration date, and the expiration date is for you if you don't use them. Okay. So, here is a little tidbit in the paper today that you may find semi-amusing. According to a Harvard researcher, eating a carrot a day will reduce your risk of a heart attack. That's good news, right? Must be true. I've never seen Bugs Bunny say, "I've fallen and I can't get up." Okay. Tonight, we have a television show for you, right here. And this was part of it. Mr. George Burns is with us tonight. Hi, Morty. How you doing? Morty's already ready, huh?
Something in the key of C will be fine.
Barry Levinson, marvelous director, is with us tonight. So stay where you are. We shall be right back. George Burns is here tonight, Barry Levinson. Let's have a little paperwork here before we get going. We did a couple of things on the show last night on nursery rhymes, updating nursery rhymes to make them more relevant with today's kids. And we started out with "There's an old woman in a shoe," and nobody could remember the last two lines. He goes, "There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, she didn't know what to do." And you drew a blank there.
The audience drew a blank.
Everybody, nobody could finish it. Any young parents here who know what it is? All right, "She gave them some broth without any bread. She whipped them all soundly and put them to bed." That's it. Okay, that takes care of that. These are just little trifling things here, folks. It don't mean too much. All right, I made a mistake. You know, I'm an astronomy buff.
Right.
Studied it for years. I made a dumb statement the other night. I was talking about they've discovered that the planet Mercury is 800 degrees around the equator and about 235 degrees below zero at the pole. They found ice caps on Mercury. And I said, knowing better, I said Mercury, of course, was the closest planet to the Earth. I meant closest to the Sun, which it is. And, boy, when you say something here, you get letters. I heard from a gentleman by the name of Jay Pasichoff, who is the Field Memorial Professor of Astronomy at the Hopkins Observatory in Williamstown. And he said, for your record, though, it is Venus and not Mercury. He says, as I'm sure you know. Mercury is the closest planet to the Sun, but Venus comes only 0.3, 3/10 astronomical units from Earth. Do you know how far that is?
No.
Let's see if I can get this right. One astronomical unit is 93 million miles.
Right.
That's the distance. And 3/10 of that is about 27.9 million miles, right?
Right.
So Venus would come about 27.9 million miles closest to the Earth.
It's so good you're clearing all these things up.
Isn't it?
Yeah. Now, I made a mistake. It's hard to believe.
About three of them, haven't you? But that's another story.
I wished a happy birthday to the Marine Corps everywhere.
Yes, you did.
And I said 217th birthday, 216th. I should have known that.
Oh, my
God.
Wow. Yeah. That's why we're here, folks, to admit that we're only human.
Right. Why is your thumb caught in your...
Because I thought I could get a laugh at it. Desperate times call for desperate measures. Who said that?
You did.
No, I mean, no. Okay, last night we were talking about the book Scarlet that's out is the sequel to Gone with the Wind. We were trying to figure out Margaret Mitchell, who wrote Gone with the Wind, and they made a movie in 1939. We were trying to figure out what she got for it.
Yeah.
And I said I thought it was $150,000. Would you believe that Margaret Mitchell, and she never wrote another book after Gone with the Wind, and she died in 1949, was paid $50,000 for the rights to that book. And apparently they didn't want to pay it because Paramount had produced a Civil War film apparently previous to that called So Red the Rose, and it was a big bomb, and they didn't want another Civil War, so $50,000. We were trying to figure out what Clark Gable got. He was paid $100,000, they said, but I don't think that's true. I think the studio loaned him out. In those days, the actors were under contract with the studio, and they could loan the services out. So I think Clark Gable got about $25,000, and Paramount probably got, or whoever he was under contract, who got the other $75,000, and that's just another little tidbit of information. And... You don't like to leave things hanging.
No.
You know, people sit home, they don't go to bed, and they say, how much did, you know, guys will be arguing with their wife. How much did she get? They don't know. You sleep well at night without knowing these things. You're probably sleeping well now, though. Let's try this. Do you know NBC's slogan this year? All the networks have slogans, little catchy things, you know. You see them all the time.
Is the place to be? Is it?
It's the place to be.
It's the place to be.
Yeah. In the early 80s, when NBC was in last place, they had slogans like, proud as a peacock. And they were in a dumper at that time. Our pride is showing. They tried that one year. And just watch us now. In 1983, they tried, be there. Now, they actually hold meetings with guys who have suits and ties, and they sit in a big conference room. Al, what do you think? How about, be there? And they take a vote, and these highly paid executives, and so they tried that. And that was in 83. In 84, here's the dramatic change. Let's all be there. And in 85, I think it was, we were there, where were you? This year. In 86, NBC came up with Come Home to NBC. They hung onto that for a while, then went back to the place to be. ABC, for example, has You and Me in ABC. Kind of nice. Now is the time. ABC is the place. Come on along. America is watching. CBS had Looking Good Together. Reach for the stars, great moments, and get ready. They hold meetings for this stuff. Be there. Great, Al. Good work. Obviously, a lot of slogans get thrown out, slogans you never hear of.
That's hard to believe.
Well, we're going to take care of that right now. We're going to show you some ones they came up with that they passed on. NBC, what will we stink of next? ABC, hasta la vista, quality. CNN, we're not just for wars anymore. The Medical Channel had one. They threw it out. Turn your head and watch. ABC, I think, is thinking a future home of the David Letterman show. MTV, you grab a chair, Madonna will grab the rest. They didn't use that. The Playboy Channel, you know they had a slogan? It was, hey, we never have a headache. The Home Shopping Network, this crud's for you. C-SPAN, you ever watch C-SPAN? That's the congressional channel. The closest you can get to Teddy Kennedy without being chased around a desk. The Discovery Channel, try this one. Be patient. The naked natives are coming right up. PBS thought of Maury Povich. Never had him, never will. HBO, this one I like. You saw them a year ago in the theater, now see them again on a tiny screen with the sides cut off. The Jewish Television Network. Did you know there's a Jewish television network? So don't watch. What do I care? I'll just sit here all by myself. The Arts and Entertainment Channel, more fussy guys in tights than any other network. All right. How many of you watch PTL? Well, maybe this slogan turned you off. Come on home to PTL, or you and your dog will burn in hell. And let's see. C-SPAN. They tried this one recently. Where else can you hear the words long dong in prime time? And NBC this year came up with, if you can't watch us, why not buy us? Ooh. That was, well, why not buy us? Yes. Okay, in a moment, Mr. George Burns will join us, and Barry Levinson, so stay where you are. Okay. My first guest, as you well know, has the longest running career in show business, and he works constantly all the time. He's got a new book out, which is titled Wisdom of the 90s. Would you welcome Mr. George Burns?
Don't sit down, I won't.
That's nice, isn't it?
Oh, nice. Johnny, it's nice to be with you.
Nice to see you,
George. Do an ashtray here?
We'll get you one right here.
Okay, good.
All right, how many cigars is this today already? What number is this?
I smoke between 15 and 20 cigars a day.
Gee.
Well, you see, at my age, if I can get it into the holder... It's exciting.
The exciting day. All right, I got it.
And if I find the hole.
Good, sure. Now, I gotta ask you this question to start off now. Are you practicing safe sex?
You should have asked me that question 30 years ago. From here up, I'm fine. From here down, I need makeup. Very, very little makeup.
You're looking good. I read an item in the paper the other day, and I know this, you've mentioned it, but you're already booked. You're 96 now, right?
96.
96.
I'm gonna be 96 in January.
Right in January. You're already booked at the London Palladium.
I'm 100.
When you're 100.
And also, I just signed a 5-year contract with the Riviera Hotel in Vegas for 5 years. I don't know which place to play. I hope the Palladium is still there. I love show business. Let me ask you something.
Sure.
How long have you been doing the show?
It'll be
39.
When we finish next May, it'll be almost 30 years.
30 years. Yeah. I've been on your show for 30 years.
That's right.
Before that, I've been on the Jack Paar show.
That's right.
Before that, I've been on the Fred Allen.
Steve Allen.
Steve Allen.
Right.
All you guys, you're all leaving. I'm the only one left.
You get this question all the time. Is there any secret at all? I know you.
Yeah,
I know
you'll tell the secret.
Yeah.
I'll tell it to your audience.
Okay.
Fall in love with what you do for a living. Terribly important. It's great to be my age and get out of bed and have something to do. I can't make any money in bed.
You gotta do this right? Well, we're gonna do a commercial and then we'll come back and talk.
Okay?
Well, I'm not finished.
No, I know you.
Come all around.
We gotta go. Okay, here we go. All right.
One more line.
Okay.
My sister Goldie made a fortune.
I know, I know. We'll be back. Okay, we're back. With Mr. George Burns.
Hey.
Wisdom of the 90s, huh?
Yeah.
Is this a little advice on how to tell when you're, when you're getting along in age or what?
I don't know if I said this before. The most important thing is to fall in love with what you do for a living. I think it's terribly important. And I think that I love it. I love it. I love show business. I love show business as much today. I started when I was 7 years old.
With the Pee Wee Quartet.
Pee Wee Quartet. And I used to sing on street corners and saloons and ferry boats. And we'd pass around the hat. Sometimes they put something in our hats. Sometimes they took our hats. We lost a lot of hats. But I loved show business then. And I was a failure from 7 to 24. But I didn't think I was, because I loved what I was doing. I did a skating act. I worked with a seal. I worked with a dog. I remember I was doing Brown and Williams, a skating act. And I was sitting in Farley Marcus's office. They used to book one-nighters. And Farley Marcus said to the secretary, I can use a dog act in Ronkonkoma. So I said to the secretary, tell Farley Marcus, Brown and Williams and the dogs are sitting outside. So we got the contract. We picked up two dogs, we went to Ronkonkoma, we skated around, got $10.
Skated with the dogs, huh?
Yeah.
Have you ever wanted to do anything else in your life? Is there anything that you wanted to do and never done?
No. Just show business.
Just show business.
I love show business. I love it as much today. Well, look, here I am, going to be 96 in January. I'm going to Tuesday, I play a date. I forget where. I got a bad memory. If I get paid, I got a good memory.
Yeah.
If I don't get paid, I can't remember the thing.
Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Can you tell me what age you became interested in girls?
In what?
Interested in girls.
I did it myself. I didn't need girls.
You didn't need girls?
No. And I was.
Now, that's really safe sex.
And I was very.
Now you're talking. And you were way ahead in the game. Yeah. Who knew?
And I was very careful. I wore gloves.
I had to bring that up, huh?
I had a very good marriage.
I know you did.
Gracie and I were a wonderful marriage. Tell you a story about Gracie. Gracie got all the laughs on the stage.
Right.
Off the stage, Gracie thought I was funny. We were married then about 27, 30 years. And she woke me up at 3 o'clock in the morning. She said, George, I can't sleep. Make me laugh. So I made love to her, and she laughed.
That's the secret, huh?
Yeah.
Now.
Well, marriage is when you get out of bed anyway.
Right.
That's the most important. The little things in life are more important than the other things. The other things, are, you know.
You think you're slowing down at all? You don't seem to.
Me?
Yeah.
Not. I love to sing.
Yeah.
I dance a little bit.
Yeah.
And if I get up and sing, I get more money.
Ah.
So when I sing tonight, I'm going to sing.
Would
here.
You say, sit here?
Yeah. You don't want to pay me.
We have a very limited
you
budget.
You want to pay me?
We have a very limited budget, so maybe you ought to do here.
Okay, I'll do it here. I'll sing here.
What do you want to do tonight?
What do you want me to do? Want me to sing?
Well, you've got a repertoire.
Okay.
You remember songs that nobody else ever remembers.
My piano player.
Morty's over there.
Third, I can't remember. Morty Jacobs. Morty Jacobs.
Hey, Morty, how are you?
Hey, Morty.
Here's... Okay. Not too long, I'll have to pay him more money. Here's a song that's 100 years old.
Okay.
Was sung by Honey Boy Evans 100 years ago. Okay, let's do it, Morty. Okay. Way down in Africa, every evening in the bamboo trees, some chimpanzees, monkey banjos, nightly would be strumming. They would be humming, it's worse than buzzing bees. A big baboon had a band and was the best in monkey land, played ragtime grand. This big baboon was requested to compose a tune one night in June. Wrote a thing that's hunky and he called the thing the monkey and they gave it to the band to play. The night was a sight when the monkeys there began to swing and sway. When the monkeys do the monkey rag, swear each monkey was on a jag. Laugh until your sides would crack while they'd curl their tails, wiggle their back. Everybody's crazy about the rag that rag. The honky-tonky monkey, they call the thing the monkey, the honky-tonky monkey rag. That's it.
I'm 95, I'm sitting at songs at 100.
95, not songs 100. Years old. It's always a great kick to have you here. The book is called George Burns' Wisdom of the 90s, and make me a promise. As long as you're going to play the Palladium when you're 100 and you got the contract with the hotel, would you come back here at the same time?
Anytime you want me.
I'll
Let
come
me
back
ask
specially.
You something.
Yeah, sure.
Why are you retiring?
I'm not retiring. I'm just leaving this show. I'm going to still do television.
Don't retire.
Oh, I won't do that.
Because you know, when you retire, you do nothing.
Right.
There's guys at our club that are retired. They play with their cuticles.
Yes.
Did you ever play with the cuticles?
It's not a fun sight, is it? No. Thanks for coming, George. Have a happy long life. We'll be right back. Oh, hi there. Well, we're just having a lot of fun here in the studio. Barry Levinson's here tonight. He is one of the premier directors in Hollywood. He's done films like Good Morning Vietnam, Rain Man, Avalon, and his current movie, Bugsy, open next month, I think the 20th of December. Would you welcome Barry Levinson? Glad you're here tonight.
Well, thank you.
Enjoyed your work tremendously, and I'm happy to find out you are a fan of George Burns also.
Oh, he's remarkable.
Who isn't, I guess?
He's remarkable. I was about 6, now that I think about it backstage. I used to try to imitate him. A little bubblegum cigar, a little guy at 6 trying to go, you know, Gracie. You know. I mean, I was terrible at it. It wasn't very good, but I was so impressed with him. I think it reminded me a little of my grandfather who smoked a cigar. Same kind of character in a way.
And still out working.
Amazing.
At 96 years of age.
It's remarkable. I used to think about my grandfather, who was a big television fan and used to watch that show, and he used to have a big problem with the television to begin with, trying to get the vertical hold and all of that. He used to, he and my grandmother used to watch, you remember What's My Line?
Sure.
And when it would flash the occupation, my grandmother couldn't read English, and she'd say, Sam, what is he? What does he do? And he would turn and say, what? What is it? So, well, what is it? What is he doing? By the time he turned back the occupation.
To fake him out so he couldn't see it?
And then they would sit in the dark for 10 minutes going, I don't know, what is he? What does he do? I don't know what he does, you know? They had trouble with color TV when it came out because it was impossible for them. And if I came into the room and if they're watching Ed Sullivan, it would be, he looked like totally maroon. Completely. And if I ever said anything about it, I said, well, gee, I mean, you're watching Ed Sullivan, he looks a little maroon. He'd say, we know what he looks like in real color. We know what he looks like.
Why is it that older people, a lot of comedians, you do stand-up comedy, I understand.
I used to years ago.
But always make fun of their folks who, as they get older, seem to have problems with technical things.
Yes.
They don't want to fool with it too much. They like the old things.
Yeah, just very simple, very simple. Because the horizon, you know, remember the old, the controls were a little more complicated for, you know, for them. And, you know, and if it would, you know, horizontal would roll, then you just sort of watch it that way. That'd be okay.
Myron Cohen used to do, remember Myron Cohen?
Yes,
he used to do a
yes.
joke about he'd drop in on his father watching television. He says, Dad, he's watching a basketball game. He says, what's the score? And the old man would say, it's 52 to 19. And he'd say, who's winning? He said, 52. It was close enough. He didn't know. It was the game. I'm going to ask you a question about, you know, there are a lot of jokes about directing. And I was watching, everybody wants to direct. They're legendary show business jokes. David Sheehan is doing an interview the other night on Channel 4 News here with a little girl. I think she's in Curly Sue. Is that a movie that's out? She couldn't be more than five.
Right.
And David Sheehan says to her, what are your goals in life? And the little girl said, you know, I hope someday, I've always wanted to direct. Now, I fell out of the couch at home because that's a standard show business joke. What is it about people that when they want to direct?
I don't know, but everybody thinks it's, you know, that they can do that.
Yeah.
You know, they think...
And they can't. You know.
It's but they think that, you know, they can do that, just like everybody has a screenplay.
Right.
Wherever you are, you know.
Right.
And there's nothing worse than saying, I got a really funny screenplay. Let me tell you the idea. And you're suddenly stuck and you can't get away from it. It's just this business. I mean, there's a great, you know, interest in it. And
but there must be some underlying reason, either the power or something, because somebody will do a television series, mm-hmm. and they haven't done more than 8 episodes, and all of a sudden next week they're directing, or yes. they want to direct. Yeah. Is it the controlling the actors, or what makes a good director? It sounds like an academic question, but I don't...
It's a combination of being able to get them to do... For the actors to be able to accomplish what the character is,
yeah.
and a certain kind of rhythm to the piece, you know, and so it's a blend of what cinematography is and what the character requirement is and the requirement of the story, yeah. the mixing of the music, all of those kind of elements go together, and there's nothing better than years ago I showed Diner to my. My grandmother, whose only comment was, because I had my sister in it, and she saw the entire movie. I said, what'd you think? We couldn't see Sharon. Couldn't see her.
That was the comment.
That was the only thing. The only thing.
Now, some directors had a reputation, some of them, Otto Preminger, who I guess got performances from their actors by almost total fear.
Yes. Well, you ever hear this? There's a story years ago that he had some actress in it, and... she came in and she was complaining. She says, I am not going to wear this dress. Under no circumstances will I wear this dress. And Preminger said, well, that's a shame because the dress works tomorrow at 7 a.m.
Oh. And that was the end of that. But apparently that worked for him.
I think that was more of an autocratic period. I think that doesn't apply anymore. I think it's a different age, and I think that...
You've heard this story, and I've often wondered if it's apocryphal. You know, they go way back when Cecil B. DeMille was supposed to have been directing some great panoramic scene, and it was hot, and all these extras were standing out there. And they were tired, and they wanted a lunch break or something. And he is talking, and somebody says something. And he stopped. Have you heard this story?
No.
And he stopped, and he says, all right, who said that? And some little girl in an extra mob scene says, why don't you stand up and tell everybody what you said? A little girl stood up and says, I was just... thinking to myself, when is the old bald-headed son of a bitch going to call lunch? And everybody froze in place, and he looked around and went, lunch. It's too good a story. If it didn't happen, it should have happened. Now, the Bugsy is based on... what is the fascination with mobsters? I mean, The Godfather and all of these pictures, Goodfellow. What is the fascination with the, I guess not just American people in general, with the, whatever they call it, the underworld, or mobsters in general?
Well, the mythology of it, I guess.
Yeah.
Bugsy Siegel is a little different than he came to Hollywood. And,
right.
And he was part of Hollywood
in a
way.
Great-looking guy, too.
Yeah, he was very, very attractive. You know, and they said he was like a movie star. Actually, he did a screen test. He did his own private screen test.
I didn't know that.
He did a screen test, and he kept it, you know, but he would like to have been a movie star.
Right.
And he had an involvement with Virginia Hill. Yeah. Love the glamour of Hollywood, and I think that's really how the Flamingo began. It was nicknamed after her.
And that was one of the very first casinos in Las Vegas, was it not?
Yes, it was really the beginning of the Strip.
Right.
And the idea was to bring the glamour of Hollywood and the celebrities of Hollywood, you know, to the desert, and he would be basically the host. So he would be the star. So that's kind of what Bugsy is about.
Yeah. But there's an aura about him. I've never had any close contact other than one night I was in a restaurant and the gentleman is now deceased, so I can say this. And it was an Italian restaurant, and Frank Costello walked into this little Italian restaurant. And it was absolutely amazing, the reaction, not of fear, mm-hmm. but almost awe. He was an imposing-looking figure, and, of course, a reputation preceded him. And it was a very strange feeling.
Well, Bugsy was very, very charismatic.
Almost glamorous, but the undercurrent of...
Yeah, the danger of it.
The danger.
Yes. Yeah. It was extraordinary. He was supposed to be, and there are a number of people who were out here that know him and tell all the different stories about...
Yeah.
You know, he was very flamboyant, you know, loved to, you know, to go out and whatever was... That's really how we got interested in it, because I wasn't really interested in a gangster movie for just doing a gangster
right.
movie. It was really the glamour and the Hollywood and the Vegas thing. You know, it was interesting. We had to build a Flamingo Hotel outside of Palm Springs in the desert.
So somebody said you worked in the desert and rebuilt the...
We had to build it because Vegas is all built up. So in the middle of nowhere, we built a replica of the Flamingo. And we also had all the dust storms that they had, I mean, the high winds, etc. And there was a couple that originally was married at the Flamingo on opening night in 1946. And they were driving along this road, and suddenly they see the Flamingo Hotel. And they said, this can't be. I mean, it looked exactly like it did 45 years before
that.
That's
funny.
And they got out and they went inside, and it looked exactly like it, and they couldn't understand, and they explained that we were going to do a movie called Bugsy. And they said, it looks exactly the way it did.
That's
so they
strange.
Thought they were in the Twilight Zone.
All right, we're going to show. I submit for your. We're gonna show a little a piece of this. What are we gonna see here?
This scene, just to set it up, he has just come back from the East Coast. He's still married, but he's involved with Virginia Hill, and he just gets to the house and he starts to tell her about a plan of his, and he sees a stranger in the house.
Okay, from Bugsy, watch him on.
Hiya. Having a good time, huh? Enjoying yourself? You like that robe, huh?
Ben! You maniac! Look what you've done! Oh, are you okay, baby? Are you hurt?
I don't know if you're hurt, but you're one lucky ship of another alive. I give you 3 minutes to get your little panties on and get the hell out of here!
It's my brother, you psychotic!
Virginia, do you really expect me to fall for that?
I don't care what you fall for. I only care that you get psychiatric help and that you never come around here bothering us anymore!
Us! Us! Could you show me some form of identification, please?
It's in my pants, in the guest bathroom.
Sorry, just very unexpected things. Are you hurt? Are you cut anywhere? Any glass wedged anywhere? Oh, God.
You're right. You're Chick. You're her brother.
He looks a little bit like Sheba.
Yeah.
Good looking chiseled face.
Yes.
We're coming right back. Stay where you are.
Good sleep.
Barry, thanks for being here.
Thank you very much.
Come back soon.
Thank you.
Bugsy opens next month.
December 13th.
Thanks for being here. Good night.
I'm humbled by that applause.